I would like to introduce our keynote speaker of the day, Ms. Kiran Majumdar-Shaw, who is the executive chairperson of Biocon and Biocon Biologics. She is a pioneer entrepreneur in biotechnology, a global influencer, a passionate philanthropist, and a global healthcare visionary. She has most recently been conferred with the EY World Entrepreneur of the Year 2020 Award, and she is also the recipient of the Padma Shri and the Padma Bhushan Awards, and we are all very, very grateful to be hearing from her today.
Thank you so much, and you know, it's such a pleasure to speak at the Festival of Science. I've always admired what Parikrama is doing, and I've always admired Shukla for all that she does for, advancing education in a very, very inclusive way in our country. I'm also very grateful to have this opportunity to listen to Dr. Pradeep Datta. I'm sure he's also playing such an important role in this area. And, you know, when you think about the Festival of Science, I think the COVID pandemic actually is the best place to actually celebrate the Festival of Science. Because if you look at this pandemic is being driven by scientific rationale. This pandemic is being solved by scientific research. And this pandemic is being evaluated, it's being tracked, monitored, there's surveillance, all because science is advancing so rapidly. And this pandemic has shown us the importance of the convergence of the various sciences. What I'd like to really start with is a very famous quotation of Stuart Firestein, who's a professor at Columbia University, who said, "Ignorance, not knowledge, is the true engine of science." And I thought that was a very powerful statement. Just think of it, children. Ignorance, not knowledge, is the true engine of science. All this time, we are telling you about why knowledge is so important. And here is someone, a professor, a leading professor, saying ignorance and not knowledge is the engine of science. And he has a book which he has written called Ignorance, How It Drives Science. And perhaps those of you who are interested ought to read that book, because he actually mentions how puzzling over thorny questions or inexplicable data is what gets research and researchers to basically find amazing and innovative solutions. So if you think about the COVID pandemic, we are ignorant about this virus. We are ignorant about the way it works. We are ignorant about how to manage and treat this particular disease. And we are still very ignorant about how to basically drive the virus away. Because as we feel that we are successful with one vaccine, we are seeing new variants emerge, and those vaccines are not very effective against those variants, and so on and so forth. So, you know, nature has thrown a challenge at us and saying, now use science to find solutions. And this is an opportunity for every one of us to find solutions, to find answers. That's what science is about. Science is curiosity-driven learning, curiosity-driven education. And that's where you learn to leverage knowledge by addressing your curiosity. This is what science is about. This is what I have learned what science is about. If you just want all the answers to your questions, that's not curiosity. That's not, science. That's just getting some pieces of knowledge. So I personally believe that this is the most important inflection point in the way we learn science, in the way we teach science. Because it is about throwing at you a lot of unexplained, unanswered questions and getting you to solve those problems. That should be the focus on this Festival of Science. What are the unanswered questions? So let's start with what happened with this pandemic. Exactly a year ago, The World Health Organization informed the whole world that there is a global pandemic caused by a COVID-19 virus, which had been sequenced a few months ago. And now they realize that this virus is quite a dangerous virus. It is very infectious. It really infects people very rapidly. And many of these people who get infected are succumbing to this virus because it causes a hyperimmune response. These are some of the factoids that we had when the pandemic started. And we had no answers at that time. But it was because of science and research that we started trying to answer every one of these questions. So the first thing was to make sure we knew how to test this virus. So very quickly, scientists came up with a RT-PCR-based test that could quickly detect the presence of a virus in any person. And they did this by taking your swabs, your nasal swabs and your throat swabs, because that's where the virus was known to enter your body. And RT-PCR tests became a very important instrument in detecting the virus. And of course, in a country like India, where we didn't have enough RT-PCR tests, our scientists came to the fore, started quickly developing their own RT-PCR tests, getting them validated. And this was quite a concerted collective effort, I must mention. And then very quickly, from being unable to test more than a few thousand a day, we can test more than a million a day today. That was the power of science, that and the resilience with which we basically leverage science to solve these kind of problems. Then, as you know, after we started having very reliable tests, we started having to look at COVID-19 patients in our hospitals to see why is it that certain people respond a certain way and a small percentage of people respond a different way. And that's where, again, scientists basically delved into how the immune system works. In certain cases, they have mild disease. In certain cases, they have severe disease. And we were very smart. Many of our AI-based computer scientists said, hey, let's start doing CT scans of these patients. And can we predict who will get severe disease and who will get mild disease? And so quickly, we started using CT scans to start stratifying the patients in hospitals, saying, this person needs to be in an ICU. This person can remain in a general ward. That was a very smart bit of computer science and scientific intervention that helped us to manage the patients better. Then came the whole point of how do we get rid of this virus? And the pharmaceutical industry came up with huge amount of research effort to quickly, you know, respond to this virus with many, many solutions. So we had antivirals being developed like remdesivir and favipiravir. We had the use of steroids, because steroids were known to actually help to manage the disease better. We had antibody cocktails, which could actually neutralize the virus. Companies like ours came up with antibodies that could actually deal with what we called as the hyperimmune response that happened, and that was creating a cytokine storm, as we called it, that was killing people. So a large number of drugs were developed, a large number of antivirals and antiviral therapies were developed. And this became also a very big opportunity for developing a protocol, a treatment protocol for different types of patients. And our doctors actually came to the fore, worked with researchers, worked with new products, did clinical trials very, very rapidly to see what would work under which circumstance. That was, again, a very powerful effort of science and scientists and researchers. And you can see, as I've spoken, you got so many different types of scientific solutions. You had biotechnologists who developed the test kits. You had geneticists who actually sequenced the genome of the virus. You had clinicians and physicians who basically worked out protocols that would work for patients. You had researchers in pharmaceutical companies who are developing both what we call as small molecules and large molecules, which were the biologics to deal with the virus, and so on and so forth. And then, of course, you had other kinds of interesting problems to solve. How do you track patients or people who are in contact with people who tested positive? So you had software scientists who then started looking at software engineers and software developers who said, hey, let's start developing apps that can track and trace these people who were in touch with any positive contact patient, and so on and so forth. You could actually then have this whole real-time dashboard and database of COVID. And we see it even today. What we developed a year ago is so useful even today. Every day there is a daily tracker of how many people are infected, how many people are hospitalized, how many people have recovered, how many people unfortunately succumbed. So this is the dashboard that has come out with this huge collective effort. And I think the most interesting thing of our times is the fact that there was such a collective effort across the world because we were all dealing with the same challenge. This was a global pandemic. This was a global crisis. And this was a call for action for all researchers in every part of the world. And that is why then, when the whole effort was how quickly can we develop a vaccine, there was this huge collective effort of deploying huge amounts of public funding, getting all the regulators to come together to say, hey, listen, this cannot be regulations as usual. This has to be warp speed regulations. We have to develop this vaccine ASAP. So let's not do the same old time-consuming sequential data evaluation. Let's get into parallel, processing. Let's get into evaluating rolling data as it comes out. And then let's try and approve these vaccines in the shortest possible time. And that's what has happened. We have seen a vaccine developed in 9 months. Never ever seen before, and we never even thought that was remotely possible. But it has happened because of the collective force of research and science coming together to give us the vaccine by the end of 2020. Those vaccines are today, and it's not just one vaccine. Today we have many vaccines that have been developed across the world. In India alone, we had our own vaccine, the Covaxin, which is an inactivated virus, which has now proved to be also a very effective vaccine. And then there is another vaccine, the AstraZeneca Oxford adenoviral vector vaccine, which is being produced in India as well, which is also helping us in a big way. So you can see that all these efforts, and then we suddenly saw the advent of what we call as mRNA vaccines. So just to give you children an idea of what these vaccines are, the general vaccines, okay, are what we call as viral vector vaccines, which is where the adenovirus, which is a harmless common cold virus, is basically made to carry in its DNA inside, in the viral DNA, a code for spike protein. And when it basically enters your body, when you get vaccinated, this code translates into your body to create spike protein against which your body then reacts and creates the immune response to protect you. mRNA vaccines decided to take a shortcut. They said, why even bother giving an adenoviral vector and give a DNA, which then has to trigger your mRNA to produce the spike protein. Let's just give this mRNA code itself to the body directly so that it just produces the spike protein in the body, and the body gives the immune response. So that is what is mRNA vaccines. And when you look at inactivated viruses or viral vaccines, you basically multiply the virus in a what they call as a BSL-3, a biosafety level 3 contained kind of a zone where you actually grow up the virus in a bioreactor And it's very dangerous to do that because you don't want it to escape. And that's why you need that high levels of safety and containment. And then what you do is, as after you multiply the virus multiple times into millions of viruses, you basically inactivate them. You kill that virus. And when the virus is killed, you then basically take it out and then make it into a vaccine. So you have now a killed vaccine, which is not harmful in duplicating itself, but it has all the components of that virus that has caused the disease. And your body then responds to that virus as a foreign invader and then creates the immune response for that virus. This is a very old technology, which is known to work, you know, very effectively over decades. So this is the way the virus vaccines have been created. And then, of course, there are many other vaccines that use different kinds of technologies, make those vaccines. But what is important is that all these vaccines are now being deployed to, you know, overcome this virus. However, we are already seeing that most of these vaccines are not even effective against the new variants. You know, some of these vaccines are known to not be effective against the South African variant or the UK variant. And now in India, we are seeing a second wave. Is that also because of another variant in India? We don't know that. We are sequencing these viruses very, very rapidly. And we'll soon know whether one variant is the same as the other, or is it different, or is it a new variant? This is the challenge that nature is throwing at us. And that's why science and research is so important in responding to this particular virus. And so today the research that is going on is really to see how we can actually develop even newer vaccines that can cover more variants. And can we have a universal COVID-19 vaccine is now the question. So I'm sure the next vaccines will be even better than these vaccines. And that's how science keeps on moving, keeps on advancing, keeps on improving. And that's how we solve our problems in a continual way. So there is no, what science teaches us is there's no one answer. There is no permanent answer either. Science is throwing challenges at us all the time and saying, find new solutions, find better solutions, and find innovative solutions. And that's the way I think we all, as you know, learn as students of science, must look at science, saying, how do we continually evolve our scientific understanding? How do we continually, find new solutions or new ways of doing things? And that is what will open your mind and get you to really ask the right questions and have that curiosity-driven learning, which really will help you to become great researchers in great science. And I must tell you, science is very rooted in data. Data has to be reliable. Data has to be something that validates what you think. So science is about asking a question, coming out with a hypothesis, generating data to validate that hypothesis, and then saying that this scientific finding is correct. That's the way you go about science. So, even when you learn science, you will also see that science has many, many facets. It's not about just one field. You have to be multifaceted in the way you think. A lot of people ask me, is it okay if I don't do math? Is it okay if I don't do physics? Is it okay if I just do chemistry? You know, these are questions a lot of students ask me when they want to get into biotech. And I always tell them, listen, as a scientist, you must have curiosity for all branches of science. If you don't have that interest in all branches of science, you will not make a good scientist. For instance, you don't have to be great at all branches of science, but you must have a general idea of what each branch of science is all about. And then focus on your area of interest. So for instance, let me start with, our great scientists of our times. So let's look at someone like, Leonardo da Vinci. We call him the Renaissance man because he was interested and had expertise in almost every branch of science, from, you know, the life sciences to astronomy to even art. And, you know, look at all that he did during his lifetime. He was interested in every branch of science. He was a physicist. He was a biologist. He was a chemist. He was an astronomist. He was an artist. He was a mathematician. I mean, you name it. He had all of these embodied within him. But, you know, you must also understand that we've had many other scientists of our times who also shown to us that it is important to be interested in other branches of science. Francis Crick, who was originally a physicist, did not limit himself to his chosen field of research. It was curiosity that drove him to collaborate with James Watson, who was deciphering the structure of the DNA. And it is this kind of curiosity and collaboration that has come out with the most important findings of science in our times. Let's look at even the Swiss engineer George de Mistral, who came up with Velcro. And it's a very interesting thing to be curious, because he was a hiker, and every time he went into the Swiss Alps, his clothing would get covered with these burrs, you know, while he climbed. And he thought, what else can I do with this burr? And it was that whole concept of learning from nature that made him invent the Velcro zip that we all are so familiar with today. Percy Spencer, one of the world's leading experts in radar technology, discovered the microwave oven when his curiosity was sparked on seeing that a candy bar he had in his pocket melted while he was standing in front of an active radar set. Things like that. So, you know, you have to apply your knowledge, apply your mind, and then that's how you answer the questions that nature throws at you. That's how you find scientific basis to a lot of your curiosity. This is what science is about. This is what curiosity-driven learning is about. And I hope that as a country, we actually get this scientific temper that is about curiosity, that is about finding new solutions, that is about validating our hypothesis through data. India is very fortunate. We have a very strong capability base in data science. And data science is going to be so very critical in the science of the future. So combining data science with a lot of your other branches of science, today biological sciences has dramatically changed the way we diagnose disease, the way we treat disease, the way we cure disease. Just look at cancer. Cancer has had a huge evolution in its understanding. Initially, cancers were only treated with surgeries. Then we started using radiation to treat cancer. Then we discovered chemotherapy to treat cancer. And today, immuno-oncology, that is the use of immunological products that change your immunology in your body to fight the cancer. After all, what is cancer? Why is cancer, happening? All this actually point to your immune system. Your immune system is the most complex and, you know, powerful system that we have. And it is the most amazing, awesome system that we have that uses algorithms, that uses all kinds of mathematical calculations, chemistries and combinatorial chemistries and protein synthesis and messenger RNAs. I mean, it is amazing what your immune system does and how you fight disease. So cancer is one such disease that happens because your immune system, for some reason, makes errors, doesn't quite know how to deal with certain signals it's getting. And so you've got to make those corrections. And today, immuno-oncology has become such a powerful way of dealing with cancers. We've gone one step further. We've also done cell therapy and gene therapy, where we've actually looked at certain diseases that are caused by deficient or defective genes, and we've corrected those genes, and we are trying to put it back into people so that they can get back to normalcy. We have looked at cell therapy where cancer patients with cancer cells we take their cells, we engineer them to fight cancer cells, put it back, and they're cured. These are the kind of marvels of science that are helping us. Let's also look at COVID. Today, we are all grappling with, should we be vaccinating older people, younger people, which people group should we vaccinate, which we shouldn't. I unfortunately believe that we are not using science intelligently. All that we have done is we have used a stratified, staggered vaccination protocol that is old-fashioned. We have not bothered to use modern-day algorithms to tell us which is the most vulnerable population, irrespective of age group, and vaccinate them first. Today, we are seeing huge surges in numbers, and we know that those surges are coming from young people spreading the disease because they are clustering together. They are in dense clusters. They are in urban dense clusters. Have we done all this mapping of how do we basically roll out vaccinations effectively? Have we developed algorithms and kind of infection maps that tell us, hey, it's better to vaccinate this part of the town for, in a major way, because once we immunize them, they won't spread the disease to this area, and so on and so forth. There are wonderful ways of finding out new vaccination algorithms, but our policymakers are stuck in an old mind, mind trap, saying, oh, this is the way you should be vaccinating people. First, let's go with the healthcare workers. Then let's go with essential workers. Then let's go with over 60-year-olds. Then let's go with 45-year-olds with morbidity. Logical for sure. It all makes logical sense. But is that the best way we should be vaccinating? Should not we be developing algorithms that tell you that this is the best way to vaccinate? Let's mingle the populations and see, are these urban clusters the best way to vaccinate? Should we be vaccinating Mumbai first in a very aggressive way, Bangalore in a very aggressive way, or where those things start spurting and surging? Those are the ones that we should knock on their heads. Are there algorithms? There are algorithms. We need to develop them. We need our policymakers and our scientists who are taking such important decisions to actually be smarter than how we are going about vaccination today. So these are the kind of opportunities that we have to use smart science, to be curiosity driven, to do things differently, and to really get us into a better place in a much better way. We should not be blindly following what everybody else is saying. WHO is a very archaic institution that tells you this is the way you should vaccinate and everybody is doing it. Why can't we be smarter? Why can't we find new models and share it with WHO so that they can share it with the rest of the world, and so on and so forth. Healthcare itself in our country needs a huge, huge revamp. Can we find new scientific solutions to how we are dealing with disease burden in our country, how we are diagnosing diseases in our country? Can we find low-cost solutions to many of our disease diagnosis and disease treatment in our country? How can we find interesting innovation that can help us in different ways? In India, we have a huge opportunity of developing a scientific model that's based on affordability and accessibility. That itself will drive you into very new ways of thinking about science and applying scientific knowledge to deliver that low cost, affordable, and accessible solution. So I will end here by saying, look, this Festival of Science is going to be a very, very exciting forum, platform, and networking opportunity for all of you to engage with and to find exciting new answers. All I can say is that every adversity brings out fantastic scientific opportunities to solve problems. And in our country, there's no dearth of challenges. It's not just COVID. We have so many challenges. We have so many adversities in this country that are crying out for scientific solutions. I challenge every one of you to look at those kind of adversities and create them into opportunities and make them your purpose problem solving. That is the message I want to give to you. Get into problem solving. Leverage scientific thinking. learn about science and develop that knowledge so that you can leverage it and create that adversity into an opportunity. You know, make sure that you answer those ignorant questions of science and make them into that engine of scientific temper. So with that, I'd like to wish you all the very best, and I'm sure you'll have a wonderful, wonderful festival. Thank you and namaskar.
Thank you so much, Ms. Kiran, for talking to us today. In fact, you started by telling us that ignorance is the engine that powers science. We have to agree with this. In fact, there's a saying that goes hand in hand with this saying, which is that ignorance of ignorance is the ending of knowledge. And it is the acute awareness of ignorance which leads to the development of knowledge. So thank you so much for beginning with that message. We also thank you for giving us such a comprehensive overview of what is going on in the world today. You also explained to us about vaccines, how they are made and how they behave within the human system. And for me, it definitely took away a lot of the fear that sprung from the ignorance of not knowing how these vaccines behave within the human system. And I'm so sure that it did that for all of our participants who are listening to you today. So thank you so much for sharing your knowledge with us. Thank you so much for being a part of the Festival of Science.